Today, we're going to go to the latter part of Matthew chapter 7. We're going to start with verse 13. It says this, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction." Notice that terminology. Wide is the gate, broad is the way, and those things are going to lead to destruction. And there are many who go in by it. Verse 14, "Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way." This life that we live as Christians is not always going to be comfortable. Jesus is clearly articulating it as in a difficult journey. Right here himself, this narrow gate is difficult. This way is difficult, which leads to life. And there are few who find it. Notice when you begin to go through this broad direction in your life, many follow that path. And if you don't watch it, there will be good church-going people that you look up to and respect that follow that broad life. But that way leads to destruction. And Jesus says there's this narrow way, and the gate is very small, and few go in by it. Jesus is really predicting or prophesying at this moment that not everybody that says they serve the Lord is actually going to make it to heaven. And you'll see that spelled out in Scripture just here in a moment. He goes on and he talks about false prophets. He says, "Beware." Look at your neighbor and say, "Beware." "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing." It's wolves in sheep's clothing. Y'all have heard that, right? But inwardly, they are ravenous. Is it ravenous or ravenous? I knew it was. I was just seeing if you did. Ravenous wolves. You know what they call a wolf in sheep's clothing, don't you? A wolf. So terrible. If you're a guest, I'm so sorry. Listen to this, verse 16. "You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit." I think Jesus is defining this because a lot of times when we disagree with someone, say you disagree with someone in the church and they're leading a Bible study or something. Now you're leaving and you're telling everybody else, "That's a wolf over there because I disagree." Just because you disagree with something doesn't mean that somebody's a wolf, okay? So let's just clarify it. I think Jesus is really having to clarify this for them. "Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." He's symbolically saying, if you're a tree that does not bear good fruit, you will not go to heaven. He's going to have to define it a little bit better in a minute, because some people's like, "Huh? What are you talking about, man?" Verse 20, "Therefore, by their fruits you will know them." Verse 21, I think it's very interesting that Jesus continues with this, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven." In other words, just because you go to church, just because you do all these different things, just because you're gifted and you function in a gift, doesn't mean that you're going to make it to the kingdom of heaven. Only those who does the will of the Father. Makes you think a little bit deeper, doesn't it? Verse 22, this is not going to be a popular sermon, by the way. "Many will say to me in that day, 'But Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?'" In other words, have we not functioned in a gifting? Have we not done different things? "Oh my gosh, I prophesied in your name. I cast out demons in your name. I did all these mighty works in your name." And listen to what Jesus says. He says, "And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you.'" Because more than anything else, it's not about a show. It's not about how good you're gifted and you can preach, or how well you can articulate words to manipulate people and cause them to think that you're a spiritual being because of the words that are coming out of your mouth, right? This isn't about all of that. This is about a personal relationship with Jesus. He told them to depart from them because he never knew them. It's like the seven sons of Sceva. Y'all remember them? Paul I know, Jesus I know, but I don't know you. Why? Because they were coming in the name of Jesus, but they didn't have the power of Jesus. That's how you know somebody, by their fruits, is the power of the Lord Jesus following up their fruits. And then he says this, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Father, I thank you so much that you're able to gift people. And I thank you for the gifts. I thank you for the many blessings that you've poured over our lives. But God, I honestly believe that sometimes we are manipulated through giftings. We look at different people's verbiage. We hear it. We think because that's what they say, that's who they are. And Father, more than anything, I pray for the spirit of discernment in our church. I pray for the spirit of discernment in the lives of people, the people who could pray to you and ask, God, is this you? Is it not? They don't have to be a 20-year veteran Christian to be able to get an answer from you. I pray that we'll seek your face, that we'll follow God, not man, that we'll always have this personal relationship with you, and that we won't be steered away from the things of God by the words of man. Let your will be done in our lives today, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. 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 You can be seated. I'm going to try to get through this pretty quick today. So if you'll give me an hour, hour and 15, I think I've got it. Hallelujah. Yeah, somebody's like, yeah, I don't know. We'll see. All right, but one of the things that I really like is this word. Jesus opens up with this word, and this word is beware. And we're going to talk about today wolves in sheep's clothing. I think that it's something that a lot of pulpits don't talk about. And I think we need to talk about it. And here's why I think we need to talk about it. Because there's a lot of good people who are being led astray by spiritual words that are unbiblical. Just because it's spiritual doesn't mean that it's biblical. Just because it's quoted doesn't mean the intent of the quote is not bad. Are y'all with me? So to beware means to pay attention to or to be cautious about. And Jesus is specifically talking about false prophets. We also hear of false teachers. We'll read some scriptures on that here later on in the sermon. But here's how you begin to identify some of these people, because outwardly they look harmless and they have good intentions. I've been around people before. They got great intentions. It's very harmless, but inwardly they're full of envy and they're full of hate and evil and deceit. It's not about what comes out of a man. It's about what's on the inside of a man, because what's on the inside will eventually come out. And these types of wolves that Jesus is trying to identify here in the best sermon ever are the people who twist the truth and they twist scripture for their own agenda, for their own purposes. Listen, they are deceivers teaching false doctrine while appearing spiritual. Just because it looks spiritual doesn't mean it is spiritual. Just because it looks like Jesus doesn't mean it is Jesus. There's counterfeits. There's fakes. Come on, somebody. We've all ran into some people like that. And we live in a culture today. Some of you probably seen some this morning. We'll scroll through Facebook and be like, oh, man, that's good. I got to save that reel. Hallelujah. That's good. But you don't know the fruit that's coming off of that. And even though it sounds good, you've got to dissect it and discern it based on what the Word of God says, not what the man or the woman is saying. Right? So a lot of times what happens is we see things that appear spiritual and we follow that. And I'm going to tell you, there is a real enemy. Someone say real. There is a real enemy who prowls around seeking someone to devour. We see it in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. We know that the devil, he's prowling around. He's seeking people. And do you think that he's going to come up to you and go, hey, I'm the devil. Let me tell you something. I'm the devil and I want you to follow me. No, he's probably going to mask himself in some type of spirituality to draw you away from the flock so that he can devour you over here. Let me tell you something about the devil. He has quoted God's word since the beginning of time. He's been twisting it, trying to manipulate God's truth. Come on. And his main goal is deceive and to lead as many people astray. From the very beginning, Genesis chapter 3, you know what the devil said? But did God really say? That was his terminology. Did God really say? And today we live in a culture, people will grab their Bibles and they'll begin to open their Bibles and go, yeah, but did God really say that that's really a sin? Because if God would have known what's going on right now, that wouldn't, I don't think that God would have said. No, God said. And if God said it's a sin, it's a sin. I don't care if it hurts your feelings or if it hurts my feelings. If you want to go out and live your own life, just know when you die, you will go to hell. I know that this ain't popular preaching, but it needs to be preached. I think we're living in a society of Christianity today that everybody's trying to preach what they preaching to build their churches and to set tails in little padded seats and get more money. I'm not in for it for more money. I'm not in for it to pack the house out. And if I am, glory be to God. Let God pack the house out, not a bunch of lies. Because what people do, they begin to lead people astray. Astray from what? What's happening in local church ministry today? People, wolves in sheep's clothing are leading people away from the local church based on their own personal theology. And you say, well, man, you've got to back that up. I can back it up. Here's how I can. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, and quit taking it out of context. Do not forsake the assembling of the brethren together. That means don't forsake gathering with other believers. And some would say, well, yeah, I gather with believers, but I don't have to have the local church. That's fine. If you don't want the local church, that's your thing, prerogative. Thank you so much. It's my prerogative. That was terrible too. Discern that. That was not godly, okay? But that's your prerogative. Don't lead other people astray because you got butt hurt in church. Are you with me? Because we do get butt hurt in church. I've been hurt in church, but I can't get away from the call of God on my life, and I love you enough to keep standing up here. Instead of trying to create my own podcast ministry and getting out of the pulpit and quit doing what God has called me to do, I got to do what God has called me to do. Why? Because this is the gifting and the call, and I've got to obey the Lord Jesus Christ. I got to fulfill His will according to His scriptures to make it to heaven. That's why we got to wake up. The devil knows the Word of God. He knows. And when he knows the Word of God, he's going to twist the Word of God. What happened after Jesus got baptized and Jesus is now, the Bible says, listen to this. This is a crazy statement. Led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. So he was literally, the Spirit of God led Jesus to a wilderness moment to be tempted by the devil. You say, well, God will never tempt us. Yeah, that's right. Because the Bible says God will never tempt us. It literally says that. There's a scripture that says God doesn't tempt us, but the devil does. Yes, he does. And God will always put us in positions to see what's on the inside of you. Amen. That's why you got to have the spirit of discernment. You've got to know what's right and what's not right. Hand me my phone real quick. I took a picture of something right there. Yeah, please. Hurry. I know. See, I was going to use this on YouTube, but now I can't because... No, I'm just kidding. Here's... To understand, I wrote this down. To understand the spirit of discernment, when you begin to pray for discernment when you're dealing with these people, to understand or know something through the power of the Holy Spirit. To understand something through the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not taking someone at their word for face value. Well, I believe that this man or this woman is spiritual. I don't care what you believe. You better discern that thing. Come on, you'll be walking around hoping for something that's not even in the will of God for your life, but it got prophesied over you. And now you're walking against the will of God, believing on man's word, not God's. I don't care if Pastor Jamie comes to you and gives you a word of prophecy or a prophetic word over your life. You better take that thing right back to the prayer room and say, Jesus, is this from you? Why? Because Satan is an imitator. He's an imitator. Imitation is what he does. It's what caused him to get kicked out of heaven. He wanted to be like God. He wanted to be God. He wanted the praise of God. If you ever get around people that won't praise, and if you don't praise them, they'll kind of shun you. Get away from those people. Run from those people. And I'm going to give you a little nugget just real quick, and I want you to understand, because a lot of us, we just look at spiritual beings. We look at positional leaders. You know, I can talk like this because I am. I am a positional leader that a lot of people look up to that say, I am a spiritual being. Right? I had a guy, it was weird, and I said, is Jesus in the room? Because a guy in the first service, and I always try to correct this stuff, but a guy says, man, I just don't know. I said, you're quiet. And he said, yeah, because you walked up. And what he was saying, he honors the man of God, right? But my whole thing is, hey, dude, be quiet when Jesus walks up.
Come on now.
And I hope I've got Jesus enough in me that when I walk into a room, people go, what just happened? But on the flip side, if someone wants to be praised or to hear that, get away from them.
Amen.
Get away from them. Here's why. Because Judas was on church staff.
Yes, he was.
And he attended every prayer meeting. Does that make him spiritual?
No.
Come on, he hung around Jesus. He was around Jesus. See, that's what we think. Well, if someone is saying the right words, if they're doing the right things, this is why God's saying, look, you got to watch out. Beware of false prophets. And I'm going to break it down for you, but here's what he said. Once you're aware of false prophets, he told us through his word. I'm not going to give you anything else. Jamie didn't come up with anything else. I just want to give you the one thing of how we can spot a wolf in sheep's clothing. You want me to give it to you? You'll know them by their fruit. That's it. You'll know them by their fruit. If you look at Galatians chapter 5, verses 16 through 26, there's 11 verses there that really spell out something that's very interesting. And it talks about a man who walks in his flesh and the characteristics of that man. And then it talks about the Spirit of God and the fruit of the Spirit. It's not the fruits, plural. If you're a follower of Christ, the fruit is going to be in you. If you're a follower of Christ, you will have self-control.
Amen.
Self-control's not going to come 10 years down the road, and I just got an attitude, and that's just how I'm driven. No, you got an attitude, and that's your flesh rising up, and you need to kill your flesh. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's this flesh versus spirit moment. And if I'm going to judge somebody by their fruit, are they reacting through the flesh or are they reacting through the spirit? Because if you ever put a wolf under pressure, what's on the inside of them will come out. And I want y'all to look at me today, and I don't know. I'll look at this camera right here. You can't house bitterness, anger, unforgiveness, resentments, and the Spirit of God at the same time, all while you're leading your little Bible study. That's when people need to sit down. They need to step back. Why? Because you've got unforgiveness. You've got bitterness. Well, God's working on me. God's Spirit is enough to where He can work on you. If you're a child of God, forgive. If you're a child of God, don't be bitter. Who cares? Listen, if I got bitter at everybody that said something bad about me, I'd be the most bitter person. I'll tell you, I can't even stand the church of God anymore. I'm tired of church people. I've been ran down two or three times this week. It happens weekly. And you think I'm kidding. I don't care. You want to know why I don't care? Because I'm just up here doing what God wants me to do. That's it. You got to have a different mentality. Just do what God wants you to do. When you get around people that's doing that type of stuff, it's deception at its finest. It is not fruit. That's not fruit, people. Well, you got to look at the fruit. Well, what does that mean? Well, if someone is doing that but still running around and doing all these other types of things, and well, don't follow them. Don't listen to that. And it's sad to say, sometimes we don't find out till years later that the man or the woman of God that we have been following and listening to and allowing to speak into our lives was living a life of sin the whole time. Do we not think that honestly God wouldn't have or couldn't have spoken to us in those moments if we really felt that check, just that minor check and like, I just don't know. Something just don't feel right. And then we pop on our knees and we begin to pray. Do we not really believe that God won't show us those types of things? Because contrary to some's opinion, Jesus hasn't given anyone an exemption from obeying his word. Amen. Well, because of my situation, I can act like this. No, you cannot. I have to forgive. I can't treat someone different because of a situation. And I'll be honest, I have treated people different in the past because of a situation. Anybody else? Come on. I'm flesh. And anytime I do that, God convicts me. God's always correcting. That's what conviction is. It's the correcting. It's the judgment of God coming down. Listen, I want to tell you something. Believing in Jesus but not obeying his word is exactly what the devil does. So if you believe in Jesus, if you're sitting here today and you believe in Jesus but you're not obeying his word, hello, Satan. The devil's doing the same thing. So now we have more fruit of Satan than we do of Christ. I was about to say something, but I'm not going to say it because I was going to be like, is this okay? Yes, it's okay because it's the word of God. Matthew chapter 24, check this out. And then many, because many right now, some of you in this room may be a little perturbed right now because of what I'm saying. Probably not because we're all holy. Hallelujah. But the Bible says, and then many will be offended. A lot of people is going to be offended when they hear the word of God preached in truth and in spirit. Many people is going to be offended. And after they're offended, they're going to betray one another and they're going to hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. Why? Leave that up just for a minute. Why will many false prophets rise up and deceive many? Here's why. Because of all of the people that have been betrayed. And now because they're feeling this betrayal, and now they're away from God, that's when the false prophet can rise up and gather his little flock. Mm. Sweet potato pie and I shut my mouth. Okay. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many, verse 12, will grow cold. You ever been around somebody that's cold? We all have. But he who endures, this is the encouraging scripture, verse 13. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. It didn't say, but he who endures through that sermon that they really didn't want to hear, that Pastor Jamie was preaching, will be saved. No, that's not what he said. If you endure all the way to the end, which means we are in a marathon. This is not a sprint. There's going to be wolves along the way. I loved it what Winston Churchill said. He said, if I stopped at every barking dog along the way, I would never reach my destination. Let me change his words. If you will stop at every howling wolf along the way, you will never reach the destination that God has for you. He who endures to the end, that's when salvation will come. That's when you're never going to split heaven wide open until you take your last breath. And if you're not living for God when you take your last breath, you will not split heaven wide open. Contrary to now popular opinion in the church. Just say a prayer, go live your life, whatever you want to do. There's a thing called grace. God's grace covers you. You can sin. You can do whatever you want. God bless you. Thank you. Come back next week. Give me your money. It's a false gospel. It's false teaching. Am I making any type of sense today? Verse 24, for false Christ. Look at this, for false Christ. Little c. There's going to be false Christ that rise up in the last days. This is Jesus speaking, and false prophets will rise and show, look, great signs and wonders to deceive. So a lot of people in the last days, there's these false Christs and these false prophets that'll rise up in the last days. And here's how I like to interpret the last days. You don't know how many days you got left. I think that the enemy's after your life. And he will put spiritual people, quote, quote, notice that I'm quoting here, okay? He'll put spiritual people in your life to get you away from the things of God. Amen. And they're going to show great signs. Oh, man, look at this. This is awesome. This is great. He prophesied over me and it came true. This is awesome. No, you told him your story 2 weeks ago. And he knew the end of it because it was easy to guess. That's why you have to have discernment in your life. He says, he's going to use all these to deceive. If possible, even the elect. Who's the elect? You and I. Even the people who are closest to Christ. He's coming for us. That's why you see a lot of these pastors, leaders, church leaders, even volunteer leaders, different people like that, that are in spiritual positions. They end up falling. Why? Because we think that we have a tenure enough that causes, it's almost like we have repellent on us because of the tenure that we have in local church ministry. We've been here for 15 years. The devil ain't going to mess with me. No, the devil's going to mess with you, just like he messes with me. Which that scripture tells me one thing. Don't follow people based on their gifting. You know what the Bible says about gifting? That the gifts and the callings of God are irrevocable. You know what that means? You'll always have the gift. You always have the gift. Somebody got a gift of prophecy, they'll always have the gift. They can use the gift of prophecy outside of the Spirit of God. That gift is not pulled away from them. The anointing on that gift is, because it's the anointing that breaks the yoke. It's that anointing. It's the power and the presence of God. When the power and presence of God is on a gift, let me tell you something. Now you're going to start feeling it. But the gift can be there and the anointing not be there, and a man or a woman of God be used outside of the Spirit of God to do their own thing. So don't follow people based on their giftings, their words that they speak, or the prophecies that they prophesy. Follow them based on their fruits, according to Scripture. Let me talk about fruit. I'm not talking about corporate fruit. How many times have we seen people stand in pulpits? Let's just say this. A lot of people would probably look at our church and go, man, God's hands on that church. Why would they say that? Because we have a lot of people coming? They say God's hands on a church because a bunch of people show up? How many times have we seen a bunch of people showing up, but then something is revealed, which is the private fruit? Come on. See, my private life is way more important than my public life. If my private life does not line up with my public life, I've got to step out of that pulpit. I don't have a right to stand on this stage. If I do at that point, I'm teaching something that I'm not even living. That makes me a false teacher. Amen. And here, I know I've been giving you problems. This is just how God's called me to preach. I can't help it, but God bless. We have church folk running around looking for a prophetic word, or running around looking for the Spirit of God. Oh, so-and-so's coming to, what's the thing downtown Nashville? What is it? What is it? Not Broadway, brother. That was your past. I'm talking about something else. He's like, let me see. Tootsies. I'm just kidding. Not Tootsies. What is it? Where the Predators play? Bridgestone. Hallelujah. I'm just seeing if y'all knew. Okay. But we're chasing the Spirit of God when you're hearing this, when you're hearing God's Spirit and His Word every day. You're hearing it from the pulpit. But a lot of people now are chasing it, going somewhere else, and they're looking at pastors that are preaching the truth like they got a third eye. Like, yeah, I just don't feel it anymore. God bless you. If you run your life on feelings, your life spiritually is going to die in about 2 weeks. You're done. Y'all with me? Which takes me, I got to quit. It takes me to some characteristics. We know how to identify them. You identify them by fruit, okay? Here's some characteristics that come along with that bad fruit. They're narcissists. They're narcissistic. It's all about them. Narcissists love two things: power and themselves. That's all they like. They want power and they love themselves. If they can gather you around them and gain power for themselves, praise God. If you don't feed into the energy and their power, I'll write you off. You're no longer invited to the little club. You can't come back to this church. We don't need you over here. Am I making any type of sense today? I think I am. I think I am. And that's what they love. They love those two things, right? And here's what happens. Relationships are beginning to be used and abused for the purpose of gaining more control. That's what they do. They use relationships to gain more control. They'll use the power of words and emotions. They play off of your emotions. Everything is emotional, right? So once they see that you're emotional, that's a manipulation point. I can manipulate you once you become emotional. This is good. They begin, these are just characteristics. They use guilt, shame, and fear to keep other people under their power. So they shame you for what you do, and then they tell you you need them. They don't point you back to Jesus. They'll mention Jesus. Jesus is in the terminology, but they point you back to them. You need what they have to offer. Preaching bed, I'm about to run. I'm serious. This is like, I've struggled this week preparing this sermon because I thought, we have to hear this. Like, this has to be said. This has to be told. Because I'm not just talking about this church, even though wolves have been in this church. Wolves have been in this church in the past, and I'm talking, I've been here since 2007, okay? So I've been here for quite some time. I'm not talking about yesterday. I'm talking about over the years, I have personally allowed wolves to stay in the church because I was a weak leader. I was a terrible shepherd. That's admitting what my faults. I'm so sorry. I've watched people, sheep, led astray by wolves in my ministry. Why? Because you're trying to pad the seats. You're trying to keep the income. I remember I was such a, can I be vulnerable with you? I was such a weak leader one time. I was such a weak leader, and my leader actually come to me and said, you've got a situation you have to deal with. And I said, I just don't know if I can deal with this. And he had to come in and deal with the situation. The problem was the people had so much influence. It was the only, we've only told several people to never come back to this church. And I don't mind telling a wolf again later on to never show back up at this church. Right? But we just didn't know what was going to happen. The fear was there because I didn't know the repercussion of the decision to kill the wolf because of the influence that the wolf got with the people. I was scared to death. You want to know what happened when we dealt with those people? The church exploded. Amen. Like, I'm serious. That was the beginning of the church exploding in Dixon, Tennessee. That next year, we grew by 500 people in 1 year. More than we were even had in attendance, we grew over double that next year. But God, you've got to watch it, and you've got to be bold, and you've got to have the spirit of discernment. I just showed you my weakness. I have not dealt with things in the past that now I'm mature enough to go, I think I smell a wolf. Oh, you're going to take 50 with you. Okay, we're going to have to do whatever we have to do, and we're going to try to shepherd and pass through the 49 or the 48, but you've got to go. See, you got to do that in your life. I think I smell it. I think I smell a wolf. You got to go, but they're my friend. I don't care if they're your friend. They're not your friend if they're taking you to hell. They're your friend if they're leading you to the water, the living water, heaven, Jesus. Woo, feel it up in here. Galatians 1, 6 and 7. He says, I marvel that you, Paul is talking to the church in Galatia, and he's addressing this in the church. He's talking about the church. I marvel that you are turning away so soon from him who called you in the grace of Christ to a different gospel, because that's what's being preached today, a different gospel. It's not the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's the gospel of the world. We are ordaining homosexualities or homosexuals and putting them in pulpits. The Bible clearly states, if you live that lifestyle, you go to hell. Now, don't you clap, because the Bible also says if you are sexually immoral, you go to hell. If you shacking up, you are not going to heaven. I don't care what your heart is. You can't live in sin and then say that you're a godly person. I'm just saying, and it hurts me. It kills me to have to preach this way in a culture. But this is what we need, because people are dying and going to hell thinking that they're going to split heaven wide open and see Jesus. But there's false teachers that are telling them different. God, help us. Verse 7, he said there's not another gospel. There's only one gospel. There's not another gospel. If you don't get your life right, you will go to hell. Where are we at? There's some people that trouble you, and they want to pervert the gospel of Jesus Christ. Somebody has to take a stand. Somebody has to get real. We got to really get real about this. This is not something that we do. You didn't just get up today and come to church. You didn't just come to go through the motions. God died for you. Help us, God. Just help us, Jesus. Help us, God. May we repent. I pray for repentance today. I pray for repentance. Because God needs us. God needs us. And people that are like this, they're unwilling to submit to authority. They don't want to be held accountable. And I want to tell you, I've never confronted a wolf that stayed around the church. Never. But they ran out of here and ran me down like a dog. You'll never confront a wolf in your life that'll hang out, that'll stay around. And you know what? The repercussion of that is they may run you down like a dog. But are you following Jesus? They may respond with anger and bitterness and all the other types of things, and they may turn it back on you and start criticizing you. See, that's how you know it's a wolf. When you call them a wolf, they're like, no, you're a wolf. No, I don't think I'm a wolf, but I just want to have this conversation. No, you don't want to have this conversation with me because you do the same thing, and you're the wolf. They literally begin to buck authority. They'll teach it. They'll teach authority. They'll teach honor. They'll teach all of the different things, but they won't live it out themselves unless it is applied to them. If you want to show that they're authoritative in your life, great. If they have to be held accountable and have authority in their life, heck no. Run from people that say, God's my authority. Hold on. Don't shoot me with that. Don't throw a tomato. God is our ultimate authority. But he puts accountability in our life. Through the scriptures, we hear that we should submit to earthly authorities. I have authority that I submit to, contrary to some's opinion. He's just out there doing his own thing. He can make his own decision. We've got a board of directors. We've got an advisory board. I have pastors in my life that listen. I've been called out before. I've had a phone call on a Sunday afternoon saying, hey, man, just watched your online feed. Can we have a conversation about 1 Corinthians chapter 5 that you just preached on? We need to have this conversation. You know what I do in those moments? I don't go, well, who do you think you are, man? You're setting up in Colorado Springs, Colorado, and I don't even need your voice in my life. I got my stuff. Have you seen how big my church is? Have you seen how the people clap when I preach? No, I'm a man under authority. Yes, sir. What do you got? Oh, wow. Oh, contextually, that's what that means? Oh, my gosh. Okay. Thank you for the correction. Come on now. Well, I'm going to leave you with a couple of texts, then I'm going to be done. Thank you, God. Romans 16. Now I urge you, brethren, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them. Watch them, people who cause divisions. He's not talking about in the world. He's talking about in the church. Note those people who are causing divisions. For those who do such do not serve our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly. And by smooth words and flattering speech, they deceive the hearts of the simple. You got to know what's real, people. How do I identify what's fake versus what's real? You've got to know the real. Quit studying the fake and start studying the real. That way, when the fake comes, you'll know it. We put too much emphasis on studying the enemy. Quit studying the enemy. Study God. And when you study who Jesus is, you're going to know the enemy when he shows up. That's just what happens. Their own belly, smooth words, flattering speech, they deceive the hearts of the simple. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3 and 5, and I'm done. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. They're not going to endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. And that's what happens in local church ministries today. And I'll just kind of tell you, we have a structure at our church, but I am not for a church structure that the congregation votes the pastor in or votes him out. It's not how we do it here. If you don't like that, that's cool. Go to Discover Class. You can see all of our stuff. You want to go to a church just like that? Here's why. I don't think it's biblical. It's not biblical. Should there be an approving process? Should there be accountability? Should the board of directors or the elders or whoever you may have in authority put their stamp of approval? And if they don't, should that person be hired? No, not if they don't. If it's not unanimous, they can't have the position. There is a process. I'm not saying that. But let me tell you something. We've got people in the pews deciding who's in the pulpit based on what they want to hear. You can't do that. You just can't do that. Honestly, y'all probably would have done kicked me out a long time ago. Hallelujah. But they turn their ears away from the truth and they turn aside to fables, because that's what happens. We make up these stories masked with scriptures. It's masked with scriptures, but we make up stories. And he says to us, he's telling young Timothy this. Timothy was a pastor of a church. He says, but you, Timothy, be faithful and watchful in all things. He actually says, watchful, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist and fulfill your ministry. So here's what this means to me. We have a decision to make. Are we going to do the will of God or the will of man? Are we going to perform all of this, everything that we do every week? Are we going to do this for man or are we going to do this for God? Or if you break it down into your groups, is your groups, think of your C groups right here in this church. Is man being glorified or is God being glorified? Now I understand God's being talked about. That doesn't mean, just because God's being talked about, doesn't mean God's being glorified. Take it to Jesus. Pray for the spirit of discernment. You for your individual lives. Are you living to please yourself or are you living to please God? Father, thank you for allowing me the opportunity today to preach your word. And God, I know that moments like this, times like this can be so tough. But I ask, it can be challenging, not really tough. It's just challenging. Honestly, when we hear it and when we hear bold statements like, if you've got sin in your life and like active sin and you know it's sin and you've got it in your life, you're not going to go to heaven. You know, somebody else may have told us different. And now we're trying to discern who's right, who's wrong. Well, your word is always going to be right. It doesn't matter who said it. It doesn't matter how much spiritual clout they have in our lives. It doesn't matter, you know, the fruit that's hanging off of that person's ministry. What matters is if it lines up with the Word of God. So help us to discern those moments today. But also, God, if there's anybody in this room that needs you, they're far from you. They've been living for self, not for you. I pray that you'll come into their life today and you'll totally, radically change them from the inside out. We need each other. If I'm talking to you, I want to say something else. And this is for everybody, actually. If you're not around a group of mature spiritual people or people that are trying their best to do spiritual things, and you're only around worldly people or you're only around that narcissist or whoever it may be, Can I ask you to change your people group? I know it's probably going to be the toughest thing that you could do. You don't have to get rid of your friends, but you've got to have some spiritual influence being spoken into your life. Some spiritual guidance. So Father, help us. Help us to identify what group to get in or what circle to be part of or whatever that may look like, because corporate church is not the only thing. I think we need both. I think we need corporate church, the assembling together, and I think we need that core group of people in our life where we learn and we ask questions and we glean and we grow. But if there's anybody in here today and you're living for self, but you need to live for God, and you know you're living for self and you need to repent and you need God to change your life, would you just slip up your hand real quick? Come on. Anybody? Yes. Come on, just raise your hand. There's several people in this room. Yes. If you're online right now, we're praying for you too. You're just as much part of this church as the people sitting here. We love you so much. Just say this prayer with me. It's not just about the prayer, by the way. It's about a life change. I've said this 100 times, but I'm going to say it one more, okay? You'll probably hear me say it 100 more. People's asked me, when you have moments like this and people raise their hands, how do you know that they actually get saved? And here's the easiest answer that I could ever say. Because their life changes. You're going to know if you truly got saved today because your life begins to change. Now, that doesn't mean you won't be walking through a sanctification process and God begins to make you whole and kind of get some of this stuff out of you. But the next time you do what you were doing last night, you're going to feel so much conviction. Why? Because now the Spirit of the living God is living on the inside of you. See, there's the change. There's the difference. And because of that conviction, you then begin to clean your life up. You don't clean your life up and then come back to God. You come to God and then you clean your life up. He does that. You can't. So, Father, I thank you for moments like this when we can have cleansing. Your word says that if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So as we say this prayer just in a moment, I pray that it touches the hearts of everybody that prays it. Their life is forever changed. Say this prayer with me. Say, Jesus, today I give you my all. I realize that I've been doing things by myself. I've been leaning on my own understanding. I've been unwise. But today I confess my faults, I repent of my sins, and I ask that you truly become the Lord of my life. Thank you for saving me and for forgiving me of my sin. Your grace is sufficient. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Come on, give God a big hand clap, church.